Krishna. Today is the festival of Govardhan Puja, and I will speak on the topic of how the Govardhan Puja represents the raising of consciousness from Annamaya Kosh to Anandamaya Kosh. So, I'll talk about this in three parts. First, what are the koshas and how the various koshas, consciousness rises from one to another, and then specifically the golden pastime, how it demonstrates that. Essentially, our state of life, our state of happiness is determined by our consciousness. We may have the best of positions around us, but if our mind is agitated, our consciousness is thinking of something unpalatable, we can't be happy. So now, the study of consciousness has been central to the dharmic texts of ancient India. You can say that most of the dharmic texts, they are highly consciousness conscious. Very conscious of where consciousness is. Today's world, especially most of modern science, is very matter conscious. If you're conscious of matter, how matter interacts with other matter, and you found a lot of knowledge about that. And there are various frames in which the study of consciousness has been analyzed, a study of consciousness has been undertaken. And one such frame of analysis is the koshas. So kosha is basically, you could say, it has, I'll take one multiple meanings, but let me take one meaning first. It basically refers to the level of consciousness that determines one's conception of life. So level of consciousness, so let's look at the five broad koshas. Does anyone know the names of the koshas? Annamaya, Pranamaya, Manomaya, Jnanamaya, Anandamaya. Yes, thank you. Now, sometimes in the Upanishads, nomenclatures might be slightly different. And hierarchies are also sometimes slightly over. So, slightly, there might be slight difference in the hierarchies. But broadly, if we consider the Pranamaya Kosh. So, Maya means full of. So, Pranamaya Kosh is where one is concerned primarily with prana, with survival. And we could say this is the level where most biology conceives life. The purpose of life is survival. Survival and reproduction. And that is where all living beings do exist. Now, living beings have incredible creativity to maintain their existence. So we could say the purpose of life is the perpetuation of life. That is one conception of life. What is the purpose of living? I just want to keep living. And most, I want to keep living, or I want to make sure that I reproduce and through my descendants I keep living, whichever way. That is the Pranamaya Kosh. Then there's the Annamaya Kosh. Annamaya Kosh is where, I need to survive, but for surviving, I need something outside of myself. We see the outside world in the Pranamaya Kosh, we see the outside world primarily as a source of danger. The outside world considers so many dangers which can threaten and destroy my life at any moment. And I have to protect myself. So the idea is that I am pitted in a battle against the outer world. Which is true at one level, but that is not the only truth. While the outer world causes a lot of dangers, the outer world also provides me a lot of things. So at the Annamaya Kosh, my vision changes that actually I need food to eat, and I need food to eat, and I get that from the outer world. So newborn babies are often in the Annamaya Kosh. For them, all of existence is potential food. They'll experience the world through their tongue. They'll suck their finger, they'll suck their toe, they'll take a toy and put it in their mouth. Because they have got nourishment from their mother's breast, which has come from the mouth. So they see all of existence as potential food. And now this Annamaya Kosh, now when we rise to higher koshas, it is not that the lower koshas are eliminated, but rather they are built on. So these are like, if you say, if you consider a staircase, when you go to a higher level in the staircase, you are already there on the lower step. Means the height which one had come to on the lower step, we are on that height and we have built on it. So when one is a higher kosha, one is also in the lower kosha, but one is moved. So when at the level of annamaya kosha, the consciousness is very much about food. And from the annamaya kosha onwards, humanity starts differentiating itself from other species. At the level of survival, we all are struggling for survival. But at the level of eating, we humans are much more creative than other animals. A cow will keep eating the same grass. Among all species, no other species is known to cook food. We don't just cook food. There are hundreds and thousands of ways in which we cook and make so many delicious cuisines. So basically, in the human form, we have the capacity to seek more pleasure than what nature naturally offers us. So a cow gets some pleasure in eating grass, but that's what nature has naturally offered us. But we humans have the capacity to seek more pleasure than what nature naturally offers. And that's why we take what nature has given, say the food ingredients, and then we combine them in various cuisines, and we make more delicious food. And a large part of humanity exists at the annamaya kosha. So, when we have festivals serve many purposes. Festivals serve the purpose of just breaking the monotony of our life. We have something new to do. Maybe we go to a new place. We do some new activities which we don't do every day. At one level, they're just a break from the monotony of life. But another sense, especially the festivals which are sacred festivals, which are festivals centered on some on Krishna, on God, then they have this purpose of raising consciousness. Now, there are different ways to raise consciousness. One is that we reject what we have and we go higher. Okay, all this is temporary, all this is material, I give it up and I go higher. The other is we use what we have for a higher purpose. We use what we have for a higher purpose. So that is what is done in the many of the festivals. So in most festivals, if we consider Govardhan Puja and Diwali, many of us who grew up in India, Diwali basically meant two things, firecrackers and food. So there's not much conception of anything sacred being the center of it. And while at one level it is unfortunate, but at another level it is predictable. Most people will be at a particular level of consciousness, and that's how humanity is. So the idea of festivals is the consciousness at which everybody is, use that consciousness for spiritualizing. Everybody wants to have a break. Everybody wants a break from the monotony. Yes, have a break from the monotony. And then Govardhan Puja is a festival which is centered on food. In broadly speaking, there is within the Vaishnava Bhakti tradition, there is the Krishna Bhakti and the Rama Bhakti. And both of them are very powerful traditions. Lots, millions and millions of followers going on for thousands of years. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Okay. Am I audible? That's difficult. Okay. Hare Krishna. So these Krishna Bhakti and Rama Bhakti traditions, they all have their own festivals, but there are some times when both of them come together. And this Diwali, Govardhan, this whole month of Kartik, there is Diwali festival which is often centered on Lord Ram and his... Is it okay or is it difficult? It's dying, okay.
We'll get another mic.
Am I audible? Okay, thank you. Okay, so then what happens is that when these two festivals come together, So there is a historical origin of the festivals at a particular time. But when they are celebrated, often they are celebrated together. So the Govardhan Puja festival is especially celebrated commemorating Krishna's pastimes. And we could see from a functional perspective, what the Govardhan Puja involves is cooking a lot of food, offering that food, and not offering that food, actually, we often make that food into mounds, replicating what the Govardhan Puja did. And then that food is distributed. Where that food is distributed, if we are kind, we distribute it to others. Otherwise, we distribute it to ourselves. So, if to, on the Govardhan Puja day, if we go to Govardhan, I do parikrama. Actually, there are so many places where people are distributing foods. You do the Govardhan parikrama. Actually, that whole day, you don't have to make any arrangement for meals. And it's a festival of food. Now, the idea is, as I said, everybody is at a particular kosha. And Annamaya kosha is a place where everyone is, more or less. Then use that kosha, that level of consciousness, to connect people with higher consciousness. So when the food is offered to Krishna, when the food is then offered by devotees of Krishna to others in a devotional context, then it is a way by which we all can remember Krishna. This is from the functional perspective. Now if you look from the historical perspective of the Leela itself, the Bhagavatam has a particular purpose. At one level, the purpose is to help Parikshit Maharaj to remember Krishna. At another level, the Bhagavatam's purpose is to establish that Krishna is the most intimate and the most loving form of divinity. And in many ways, the whole idea of Krishna as God is highly counterintuitive. Because Krishna doesn't look any way like a stereotyped conception of God. Krishna is, in the Abrahamic religions, for example, they have the idea of God as an old man wearing a beard, sitting on the clouds, sending thunderbolts on the sinful to cast them to hell forever. And when people with these conceptions, they came to India, they came to North India, to the Mathura area, and they saw these beautiful temple carvings and wall paintings of this sweet little boy all over. They asked, who is this? This is God. God? What is he doing? He's stealing butter. He just became intellectually short-circuited. One of the qualities of God is that he can never do anything immoral. So how can God steal? And even if he has to steal, why butter of all things? So, it is a very difficult, and it's not just for people who are unfamiliar with the Vedic tradition to appreciate this Krishna conception of divinity. Now, Krishna is God, but he doesn't delight in his godhood. He delights in the full gamut of emotions that comprise a rich relationship. And thus, he doesn't want just people to ask him. He doesn't want the master-servant of parent-child relationship. He wants the inverted relationships. He wants it and his devotees also want it. So Krishna offers that. So he becomes a child and his devotee becomes his mother. So Krishna, is this form of divinity, is difficult for anyone to appreciate. And this happens even to those within the great Vedic tradition, even to the devatas. They find it difficult to appreciate Krishna's divinity. And the Bhagavatam, in the 10th canto describing certain pastimes, shows how... Am I audible still? Oh, it's difficult. Yeah. I'm audible, okay.
Yeah.
Hare Krishna. Okay. Like this. Okay, hold it. Hold on. Hare Krishna. So Krishna is Hare Krishna. Okay. So I'm empowered again now.
Then every day you become disempowered.
Okay. Hare Krishna. Okay. Yeah. Is it okay? So when Krishna is this particular form of divinity, is something which is very difficult to appreciate even for the devatas. Now, it is described that the devatas themselves, they came and they prayed to Krishna when he was in the mother's womb. That Garbhastuti, you know, the celebrated section of the 10th canto of the Shrimad Bhagavatam, where they offer prayers to Krishna that you have descended for elevating us. You are the ultimate truth. So there are many beautiful verses over there. But the very nature of Krishna's pastimes is such that Krishna acts like such a sweet, helpless, dependent boy that everyone forgets that he is God. So what the Bhagavatam does is it repeatedly reminds. And it reminds by showing how even great personalities. So in the hierarchy, there is the terrestrial level, the humans are there, and above us, the gods are there. So the celestial is above us. So the terrestrial, celestial, and above this is the transcendental. So the earthly, the heavenly, and the spiritual. Now Krishna descends from the spiritual level to this level. So in a sense, Krishna exists above the devatas. But when he descends to the world and he functions in this world, he acts almost like an ordinary human being. And thus, even the devatas get deluded, thinking that he belongs to this level. And when this perception might come, Krishna suddenly manifests his omnipotence. And he demonstrates how, although he is existing at this level, he doesn't belong to this level. So there are some traditions who say that God is infinite, this world is finite. And they say the infinite can never descend to the finite world. How can the finite house the infinite? Well, that is true at one level, but the proper understanding is that God is infinite, but he is not stuck with his infinitude. Like some people are very tall. They can see above everybody's head. But then if there's a load over, they are stuck with their height. They cannot suddenly decrease their height. They have to bow down, they come inside. So somebody who's tall, they are tall, but they're stuck with their height. Now Krishna is infinite, but Krishna is not stuck with his infinitude. Krishna is infinite, but his infinitude is such that he can manifest in a finite form and still remain infinite. So his infinitude is not that he cannot come in the finite, in the finite form. He can come in a finite form, but still he can manifest infinite potency through that kind. So when Krishna descends to the world, even though Indra, Brahma, all of these devatas have come and they prayed to Krishna earlier, but when Krishna's leela starts, then they become bewildered seeing this. And there are two main devatas who are bewildered by Krishna's Vrindavan pastimes. Who are the two devatas? Brahma and Indra. Now, Brahma and Indra, both of them are very great devatas, and specifically mentioned in the Garbhastuti, Brahma and Indra both had come over there. But both of them get bewildered. And there is a slight difference, which we will not go into right now. But in the case of Indra, it is that he, at one level, Krishna provokes him. So there are times when Maya provokes people, and there are times when Krishna provokes people. Now, at one level, Maya and Krishna are very different. We say Maya is the force of illusion, and Krishna is the ultimate reality. That's true, but ultimately, both of them are serving the same purpose. So, both of them are ultimately drawing us to a higher understanding. So, when Krishna provokes, it is like, say, suppose the spiritual master tests us. Then at that time, there is some other option the spiritual master actually doesn't want us to do. We don't do this. So, it's actually, it is being done to check what is our understanding. So, I was in Australia, somebody asked me this question, that if God is good, then why are there so many bad options in the world? If God is good and wants us to do good, then why are the bad options so many and the good options so few? I answered, that's how it always is in any multiple choice exam. So, four wrong options, only one right option. You know, maybe in America, the student can sue the teacher. You who have rigged the game in such a way that I'll pay. You set the passing marks at 40% and the probability is only 20% I'll get right. Well, you're not meant to answer the question based on probability. You need to answer based on your learning, your education. So, when Krishna only gives us the right options and Krishna only gives the wrong options. And he gives us knowledge if we want to choose the right option. So, in this particular Leela, it is Krishna who provokes Indra. And why does he provoke? Because at a bigger picture level, it is that the Bhagavatam and Krishna is acting in such a way that those who might misconstrue that Krishna is an ordinary person, for them it is demonstrated that Krishna is greater than even the greatest gods. But at other level, Krishna is also educating Indra specifically. So how does Krishna provoke Indra? And every year, the Vrajavasis they perform this Indra Puja. And the Indra Puja centers on making offerings. The idea is that we live in an interconnected cosmos. And at the earthly level, we get many gifts from the celestial level. We get air, water, we get grains from the earth. And then we need to offer tributes. Just like we offer taxes to the government. Similarly, the universal government also we meant to offer. So the Vrajavasis accordingly are performing yajna. And the yajna is performed at one level, just like if you consider the government. The government needs taxes to function. But at other level, if a particular part of a state or a country stops paying those taxes, it's not just the government's revenue is cut off, but that is an act of defiance. You are rejecting our authority. And then the government may take action because of that also. So the Vrajavasis at one level are doing the right thing. They are offering Indra Puja. But what in general, whenever anybody is in a position of authority, the tendency is that when we gain a position of authority, we forget that there is a higher authority above. That is the nature of Maya. In the 16th chapter, Krishna says in the Bhagavad-Gita that Ishvaro aham aham bhogi siddho aham balvan sukhi ko anyo asti sadrusho maya. Who is there like me? Who is there like me? So Indra is in a position of authority, and at one level he is a devata, so he is authorized to receive sacrifices. But when we are in a position of authority, the tendency is to think that we are the supreme authority. And Krishna wants to correct that. So here, what does Krishna do? Krishna very sweetly speaks to the Vrajavasis and says, actually, you don't have to do any sacrifice to Indra.
Now Indra, Indra is simply an officer who has to do his duty. So if we do our dharma, then he has to cure us. He's not doing any favors for us. Because if we do our dharma, if we do, we take care of our cows and we do our duty as cowherds, Indra has to give rings. So basically what Krishna does is, Krishna speaks the karma mimamsa philosophy. Karma mimamsa is, it is described by Acharya Baldev Devotion, says that, suppose somebody hears a class, it's a complicated class, and they don't understand the class properly. So generally it is said that if the audience is attentive in a class, they will get about 20% of the class, if they are attentive. And only God knows which 20%. So the six systems of philosophy, so in India, the Vedas are generally considered to be authority, but the Vedas, when they are heard, they are quite complicated. So if you ask six different people, what is spoken in the class today? It's quite likely that they will give quite different versions. That they will, because everybody registers, something registers, and that's natural. But then if somebody says, this is all that is spoken in the class, then it is a problem. So what happens is that when the Vedas are heard, then based different sages hear the Vedas and they gain certain understandings and they teach those understandings. So that's how the six systems of philosophy came up. One of those is the Karma Mimamsa. Karma Mimamsa is a progressive. So just like say different people, they hear somebody who is a very new person, they hear one or two points and they understand it. Somebody is a very seasoned devotee, very attentive, they themselves are a speaker. Then if you ask them, you're most likely to get the most accurate understanding of what was spoken. So similarly, it is said that the six systems are progressive. So the yoga, Sankhya, Karma Mimamsa, then Vedanta is the final. So Karma Mimamsa is one of those philosophies where one hears the Vedas and gets a partial understanding. The Vedanta is the most conclusive understanding. And in the Vedanta Sutra, Valdevidyabhushan, first Vyasadeva himself and Valdevidyabhushan's commentary establishes how Vedanta is the highest. So Krishna here speaks the Karma Mimamsa. Karma Mimamsa means that he speaks a slightly distorted understanding of things. Sometimes you can just tweak a sentence and give a completely different interpretation. Suppose some devotee is to be recommended for some post, maybe for initiation or for some responsible service in the temple. And somebody who wants to recommend them, let me say, he had problems earlier, but he is stable now. Somebody who doesn't want, who opposes the recommendation, he'll say, he's stable now, but he had problems earlier. So, the facts are the same, but the twist that is given to them is completely opposite. So, what Karma Mimamsa does is, it is true that if we do our duty, we will get the results. But it is not simply our duty that produces the results. It is our duty, then it is sanctioned through some higher authorities. So what happens? Krishna, he just removes Indra from the picture. And so here Krishna is the absolute truth, but he is not speaking the absolute truth. He deliberately speaks something else to provoke Indra. And when he speaks this, naturally, Indra becomes provoked, agitated. Since Indra is agitated, and this Vrajavasis, they have stopped the sacrifice. They're not doing sacrifice for me. Suppose there is a big program and say, you were invited as a speaker for that program, or a chief guest of honor for that program. And then suddenly you come to know that you are not invited as a chief guest. Oh, really? Then you ask, who's invited? And then you find some utterly unknown, nobody's invited. It's one thing to be replaced, but it's another thing to be replaced by somebody who's utterly unworthy. It's like, say, some some big cricket player is there and expects to be in the team, maybe consider themselves the star of the team, and then they are not included in the team. Some utterly unknown player, look, nobody has heard about that person. Itself is bad enough, but to be removed and replaced by somebody who is not even worthy, that's outrageous. So Krishna, when he wants to provoke, he does a full provocation program. So he tells that there's no need to worship Indra. And then after that, he tells a philosophy that is actually wrong. I was once at a mediation, and then one devotee told another devotee, if you want to speak a lie, at least respect my intelligence by speaking a believable lie. So Krishna speaks a philosophy which is not the ultimate philosophy. And he stops the sacrifice, and then not only stops the sacrifice to Indra, and he replaces that with a sacrifice to whom? To Govardhan. Now, for Indra, it's just a hill. He says, even the god, the king of the gods, is replaced by a hill. It's just unbearable. Certain limits. If I get angry, I might yell at someone. But I'm not physically, maybe assault someone. Or even if I physically assault someone, I just use my fist. I'm not using a knife or a gun or something like that. But depending on the kind of samskaras, the kind of impressions we have, our impressions create our boundaries. That these are the boundaries I will not cross, no matter what happens. It's not that these boundaries are entirely non-negotiable. Sometimes based on the association that we are having, the kind of people we see and perceive, those boundaries may also be negotiable. But we all have certain ideas. This is unacceptable. No matter how angry I get, no matter how I'm provoked, I'll do this, but beyond this I cannot go. So generally, the difference between the devatas and the asuras is not that the devatas are spiritually conscious and the asuras are materially conscious. Devatas are also materially conscious. Devatas also want worldly pleasures. But the devatas have boundaries. The devatas, Vishnu Bhakta Suto Deva Asuras Tadipadhyaya. However, when the Bhagavatam describes, at times, the devatas, they cross their boundaries. And one time I was asked this question that Indra, he keeps committing so many mistakes. Why is that? Why do we consider Indra to be like such a respectable person? He keeps committing mistakes after mistake after mistake. So we have to understand that actually the Bhagavatam is demonstrating the glory of bhakti as compared to punya. So Indra is the highest position to be attained by living a life of punya. Somebody lives very virtuously with all the good things in life. Good, not necessarily devoted to God, but good, punya. Then they can attain the post of Indra. The Bhagavatam is showing punya is good, but it is not good enough. Bhakti is far greater. So, to demonstrate how bhakti is greater than punya, time and time again, the Bhagavatam uses the summit of the path of punya as a tool to demonstrate the glory of bhakti. So, if we read the Rig Veda, which is primarily a book of punya, then the glory of Indra is talked about in great terms. So context is very important. It's not that Indra is not a respectable person. But in the bhakti texts, it's the purpose is to demonstrate the glory of bhakti over everything else. And that's why this particular angle is taken. So suppose, to give a simple example to understand this. Suppose maybe there is a video CD which is going to teach some cricket players leg spin bowling. And now if somebody wants to teach leg spin bowling, you don't say just some ordinary player getting out. You know, maybe some world champion player. You know, how this, until this time, this leg spin made him out like that. This leg spin made him out like that. Now if somebody sees only that CD, this batsman, he only gets out. He never scores any runs. Now, that batsman is a champion batsman. And if you want to know about that batsman, read other books about, read other things. This is a CD about leg spin bowling. And then how even a batsman as great as that can be clean bowled, can get out. That's described. So we shouldn't, and sometimes we start thinking of Indra almost like a cartoon character. So he always keeps doing things which are inappropriate. But it's not like that. It's Krishna, and Krishna is using Indra to serve a particular purpose over here. So when Indra gets angry, he crosses all limits. And he's provoked. It's like, suppose like earlier I said that say a particular district or a particular county doesn't pay taxes to the state. And then the tax can, the county can maybe impose some sanctions or have some disciplinary action. But suppose the county, so on the county some disciplinary action can be done. But suppose the state comes and drops a nuclear bomb and destroys the whole county. That is disproportionate. So what Indra does is the equivalent of dropping a nuclear bomb on Govardhan. He just gets all the power at his command. Yeah, there are severe rains, kind of rains that he dispatches at the time of universal destruction. Somewhere to Bhakarabhus. And not only there are rains, there are severe storms, there are thunderbolt, there is lightning. And there is, he makes his full attempt to destroy the dawn. So it's significant. See, anger is very peculiar. In the sense that when anger comes, and whom the anger will target, it's not so easy to understand. When we get angry, quite often, this is generally if we consider most other anarthas, if there's lust or there's greed, usually the trigger for the lust and the target of the lust are the same. Trigger for the greed and the target for the greed are the same. That means, oh, I see this, I want it. But in anger, what happens? Often the trigger is one and the target is another. And sometimes we happen to be the target. And we don't know, what did I do? We may have done nothing. So, in one sense, Krishna has provoked Indra. But Indra's anger goes toward the Brajavasis. He is still not digesting the idea that Krishna is God. And he thinks, if Krishna is a child, Balisha Panditamanina, he is a small child, Vachalam, he thinks he speaks very smartly. But his anger is not with Indra. His anger is with all the Brajavasis. He is a child, he may speak whatever you want. How dare you listen to him? How dare you listen to him and you stop my sacrifice? You are doing that sacrifice? If you stop it, you deserve to be punished. And also he thinks that if the Brajavasis are punished, then Krishna is also punished that way. So he tries to destroy all of Vrindavan. And at that time, what Krishna does is that Krishna, basically, first Krishna has replaced Indra with Govardhan. And then, after that, so that itself is a big, big blow to the ego of Indra. But as I said, Krishna wants to give a treatment. It's like a pro treatment. Yes. In the Chaitanya Charan, this is an expert physician, when they do a surgery, they remove all traces of the disease. So here what Krishna does is, he doesn't just say that Govardhan is to be worshipped, but Krishna shows how Govardhan is stronger than Indra. How he does that is, the Brajavasis stop worshipping Indra to worship Govardhan. And then Krishna uses Govardhan to stop the entire attack of Indra. And Krishna looks Govardhan and he calls all the Brajavasis. And Krishna calls all the Brajavasis to come. Now somebody might argue, you know, how can a small boy lift up a whole hill? Now, if somebody is, to be rational is good, but to be ultra rational is not. So somebody says, if I have this phone, well, no apologies if I do anything to the phone now.
So if I try to hold it on my little finger, it's very difficult. I'll have to find the center of gravity and then balance it perfectly. So even if it is not too heavy and even if I could balance it, but still I have to first find the center of gravity. So how did Krishna find the center of gravity of Govardhan to hold it aloft?
Well, Krishna doesn't have to find the center of gravity because he is the source of gravity. Maya Dikshena Prakriti. The laws of nature work under him. And God performs miracles. Miracles are not against science. They are above science. We still accept the validity of science. But then God is above that. And sometimes God can intervene in miraculous ways. And Krishna had a particular purpose. So Krishna used Govardhan to lift, to protect the Vrajavasis. And Krishna's mother Yashoda became very anxious. Says, Krishna, how can you lift this big Govardhan? And mother Yashoda said, actually, Krishna told mother Yashoda to pacify her. She says, actually, I am not lifting Govardhan. This Govardhan is so satisfied and happy with all the bhoga that we offered him that he is himself risen in ecstasy. And he said, I am keeping my finger just for you. So, in the yajna, the Vrajavasis had prepared big sacrifices to give to Indra. But all that was given to Govardhan. So Krishna is saying that Govardhan has risen in ecstasy. And Mother Yashoda says, if it is really true that Govardhan has risen in ecstasy, then remove your finger. And all the Vrajavasis, no. Don't remove the finger. So Krishna holds on to the finger. Hold on the finger. And in the Anandamaya Champu, Kavi Karanapur describes, normally we do hear that actually nobody was hurt in Vrindavan. Nobody at all. Everybody was perfectly protected. Not even the hair of anyone was hurt. But Vishwanatha Chakravarti says, then what to speak of the hair of any Vrajavasi being hurt? Not even a leaf on Govardhan was broken. So he says, not only those under Govardhan were protected, what was above Govardhan also protected. So it's like sometimes you see maybe a boxing match and some big powerful boxer comes and it's a big blow. And the other person, nothing happens. Hey, what happened? He comes there again, nothing happens. Hey, this boxer looks very dangerous. Nothing is happening. So Indra comes and keeps hitting blows for 7 days. And nothing happens at all. Not nothing happens to Vrajavasi, nothing happens to Govardhan. So what Krishna does is completely demolish Indra's pride. So, Ekadehana Indra Kumaro Naka Upara Govardhan Daro Naam Puro Kiritari Radhe Shyam Shyam Shyam. This is described that Krishna didn't even lift the Govardhan on his little finger. The little finger itself is in one sense the weakest part of our functional limbs. So now it said that Krishna lifted Govardhan on the nail of the little finger. Thought even the little finger. And he used that system. One big wrestler comes and somebody else with the left hand catches them and knocks them away. Humiliated, you with the left hand. Or somebody just comes and touches the left finger. Pow, yes, go. It's bad enough. And somebody just comes and touches the scratches with the nail of the left finger. So Krishna, when he wants to take away the pride of someone, Krishna does that thoroughly. And Indra is completely mortified at that time. He's the whole universe. He has exhibited his power and he's realized I'm powerless. After 7 days, he gives up because he just has nothing left. Just keep it draws. And then, generally what happens, as long as we are caught in thoughts of our own power, we don't think of any power bigger than ours. But when we start finding that our power is not adequate, that's when maybe there is a higher power. And maybe somebody can help. So, Indra is not demoniac, but in this particular purpose, in this particular context, he gets caught in demoniac consciousness. And then he starts thinking. And gradually, when that intoxication of his own power goes down, then he starts thinking, is there some higher being? A few months ago, there was this Cricket World Cup. I was in Australia at that time. So, one of my friends had gone from, not only what, he had gone from India to UK for watching the Cricket World Cup. And at that time, the India-Pakistan cricket match was supposed to be at the height of the championship. And just at that time, a lot of matches apparently were wiped out because of rains. And he called me when I was in Australia and he said, you know that, I have purchased this India-Pakistan match ticket for £1,000. One ticket. £1,000 is almost like, it's $1,500, so one ticket. And he said that, you know, I know you are devoted to God. Can you pray to God that at least the rain won't come? They say, I'm not even praying that India should win. Just the match should happen. Apparently, the ICC has the rules that if even one ball is, if no ball is bowled, then you will get a complete refund. If one ball is also bowled, then they will have a refund. But he said, I haven't got this ticket in black, so I'm not going to get any refund. So please. So generally, when we start recognizing that it's beyond my power to do anything, then we start thinking of some higher power. So Indra was exercising his power to the full extent. And when it just didn't work, that's when he started getting aware. And then he realized that I have made a big, big mess of things. And then he got Surbhikam. He went to Surbhikam and he says, please help me. And then when when somebody is angry with us, we feel afraid to approach that person. So they're already angry with us. But if there is somebody who is dear to them, we go with them. Then what happens is they may see us and become angry, but they will see that person and feel happy. And hopefully the happiness will trump over the anger. I will not use that word trump. We'll conquer over the anger. So with that hope, okay, you know that cows are very dear to Krishna. So he goes to the Surbhi cow. And it's Indra thought earlier, I am the shelter of everyone and they have to take shelter of me. How dare they don't take shelter of me? So he saw that he was replaced by the Govardhan. But then now that same Indra had to take shelter of a cow. So Krishna demonstrated the glory of Govardhan and also of the goats, of the cows. And then when he comes to the cow, now Krishna has served his point. So Krishna doesn't. So Krishna will take away our ego and whatever it does. But Krishna doesn't humiliate more than necessary. So Krishna, he doesn't demand that Indra come in the middle of Vrindavan and in front of all the Rajavasis seek forgiveness. It's privately when Krishna is going out in the herding the cows go a little farther away, and Krishna goes away and Indra takes that time to come. Now, at that time Indra offers beautiful prayers. He says, please forgive me for what I did. And Krishna says at that time that actually all this was done by me just so that I can free you from your pride. He says, and he says, I want you to retain your position, but don't have that same disposition that you have. So remember that you are my servant. And have this position in the mood of service. So devotion is not so much about changing of position as about changing of disposition. So the disposition is, I am the enjoyer, I am the controller, I am the boss. Whereas I am the servant, I am the contributor. I am here to assist and serve Krishna and his devotees. This is have that mood, and with that mood you can go back. And Krishna at that time, he doesn't express much anger towards Indra. Because the whole idea there is that Krishna has served his purpose. So Indra, he had this earlier, all these offerings were made to be made to him. And he was furious when those offerings didn't come to him. But then what happened? Those offerings, they're not for him as a devotee to get the offerings is not the problem. But for him to develop the entitlement mentality, to think that I am the Lord, that is the problem. So Krishna did not deny him that, but gave him a higher consciousness. So we all may be at a particular kosha. We cannot suddenly leave pranamaya kosha or annamaya kosha and suddenly jump to the ananda-maya kosha. But the level at which we are at, from there we spiritualize our consciousness. So bhakti is a process that can take us to the highest level, but it can also come down to the lowest level where we are at and take us up from there. And that inclusion of bhakti is what is demonstrated repeatedly in the Bhagavad-Gītā. And even people who are considered to be low born, even they are elevated. And that same importance of bhakti is what Śrīla Prabhupāda brought to the world. And the Govardhan Puja is not a very widely known festival outside of the Krishna Bhakti tradition in India. But by Śrīla Prabhupāda's mercy, the Govardhan Puja is now celebrated all over the world. And we all have the opportunity to relish Krishna's mercy through hearing the pastime, through meditating on the lessons that Krishna has conveyed through the pastimes. And of course, through offering Krishna wonderful prasad and offering wonderful bhoga, and then honoring and sharing that bhoga, that prasad with everyone. So this is the wonderful blessing of the Govardhan Puja, that from where our consciousness is, we connect that and raise it toward Krishna. So let us conclude with a prayer to Govardhan. Namaste Girirajaya. Govardhan Namine. Ashesh Klesh Nashaya. Paramananda Daine. Giriraj Govardhan Ki. Govardhan Puja Ki. So quickly summarize and conclude. So I spoke today on this theme of from Annamaya Kosha to Ananda-maya Kosha. Talk about the koshas as levels of consciousness which shape our conception of life. So only life, survival is the purpose of life, or food is the purpose of life, or experiencing spiritual ecstasy is the purpose of life. So from the process of bhakti is, from wherever we are, we rise higher. So in the Bhagavatam, because Krishna is a very counterintuitive conception of divinity, the God is a small child, and he seems to be such an innocent and almost helpless kind of child. So the Bhagavatam alerts us that this is not periodically, that this is, don't get carried away by appearances. God is infinite, but he is not limited by his infinitude. He can manifest in a finite form also. And I talked about how, in this repeatedly, the Bhagavatam demonstrates how even the greatest of gods are proven to be lesser than Krishna, whether it is Brahma or Indra. And that doesn't mean that they are not in small beings, they are great beings. But when Indra is shown to be given in the state, that is to show how the summit of the path of Punya is also inadequate as compared to the path of Bhakti. And Krishna deliberately provokes Indra to purify him of his pride. Krishna provokes him first by taking away the sacrifice that's meant for him, and then giving the justification of karma mimamsa, which is like a partial understanding of the Vedic teachings, and then replacing it in Govardhan. And Indra gets angry. Although devatas are meant to have boundaries, he loses all sense of perspective and he wreaks havoc. But then Krishna uses the same Govardhan to whom offered instead of Indra to thwart Indra completely. And then Indra realizes his powerlessness and then turns towards Krishna with Surya. And then Krishna doesn't humiliate him any further. Krishna tells him that you don't have to give up your position, but just change your disposition. Don't think that because you have a position of authority, that means you are the supreme authority. Rather, be in the position of authority and serve the supreme authority. So we all can, through the festival of Govardhan, remember this pastime and its lessons and deepen our Krishna consciousness. Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
So why is that after learning this lesson, Indra still opposes Krishna afterwards? Yeah, that is the nature of the material world, that forgetfulness comes repeatedly. That Indra, although he learns a lesson, he learns quite a painful lesson, but still the nature of illusion, he is surrounded by heavenly opulence, and in that heavenly opulence it's easy to forget. So the Bhagavatam demonstrates through the repeated mistakes that Indra commits that the power of illusion, especially, so Indra is the king of the gods and he lives in opulence. And just as in the Ramayana we have Sugriv. He was devoted to Ram, but after a long time when he came back to the palace, he just forgot himself in rebellion. So Indra, although he has access to great sages, but he is constantly surrounded by heavenly opulence, the apsaras and all the power and the enjoyment. So the tendency to forget is there. And we are all existing in the world and we are surrounded by worldly temptations and worldly distractions. So we have to be cautious. And that's why we need regular association, regular reminders. So it's that if we can learn by hearing, then we don't have to learn by experiencing. But Indra somehow, he has to repeatedly learn by experiencing. Okay? Okay. Yes, ma'am.
From what we gathered in this class of yours, the power of water, the power of wind did not affect Govardhan.
Yeah.
What we also know that during that period there was a flood all around, and Krishna was using this as an umbrella. But what we know, even umbrellas don't work when there is a huge flood. But the Brajavasis were saved. Both Govardhan was saved as well as Brajavasis were saved. How do we understand this? From where do we understand this?
Okay, good question. So if there was a flood all around, then you could say the water coming from above did not affect. But what about the water coming from below, from all around? So it's described that in Gopal Champa also described that Krishna, he when he comes to Govardhan, he climbs on a small stone. And then on that stone, he lifts up Govardhan. And then what happens is that stone by Krishna's mystical potency expands. And so everybody comes at a level that is slightly higher than the normal level. And then whatever water comes, that water comes, but it doesn't overflow in that particular area. So that's how Krishna, he expands that stone and he mystically uses the water so that prays that the water doesn't flood over there. So that's how his Vrijavasis are protected. Okay, when the Govardhan Lila happened in the next Manvantara also, when say Bali Maharaj will become Indra. See, generally the Govardhan Lila happens only when Krishna descends into the world. And Krishna doesn't descend that often in the material existence. So his descent is very, very infrequent. You know, that whole cosmic cycle. In which it's we are all in a sense very, very fortunate. So when Krishna descends, to be not very far away, just a few thousand years away, as compared to millions of years that are in the cosmic cycle. And even if it is, say, Bali Maharaj becomes Indra, then also sometimes even the great devotees of the Lord, they apparently get deluded, and it's just a part of the leela of the Lord. So we have these examples of sometimes great devotees, they just say, like Narad Muni, it is said that Narad Muni also offered obeisances to Hiranyakashipu. Only Prahlad did offer obeisances to Hiranyakashipu. Lakshmi Devi was also afraid of Narasimha Deva, but only Prahlad was not afraid of Narasimha. So is it that Narad Muni was also in so much bodily consciousness that he was afraid of Hiranyakashipu? No. It is for in that particular pastime, the glory of Prahlad is to be demonstrated. Then the Lord inspires all other devotees to take roles in a way that will further Prahlad's glory. So similarly, whatever is required, sometimes devotees may also act in non-devotional ways because some purpose of the Lord is to be served. Just like Bhishma fights against the Pandavas. That is, so even if a great devotee like Bali Maharaj becomes Indra, then he can still act in this way just to further the Lord's pastimes. Thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki.